Couldn't make it to this conference. She would have loved to be in here to see you all. This is her paper. It's titled Holography, a Love Story. My story, like for so many holographers, is a love story filled with joy, frustration, threats of leaving to take up with more pliant mediums such as video, but always returning for the sheer beauty and magic that holography offers. It was the late 60s, early 70s, and Peter, my husband, and I had been hearing about holography in a general way. Peter was making reflective sculptures with mirrored bases completing the form so the object was hovering in an ambiguous space. Holography sounded very interesting and perhaps a natural progression for Peter's work, but how and where to find it? Sometime later, we drove back from a vacation in Vermont with a car full of belongings and sculptures. We parked in front of our building on Prince Street and started to unload when a man walking down the street asked if he could help us. His name was Lloyd Cross. He and his very pregnant wife, Linda, had rented the loft for the summer in our building, and that was when I saw my first hologram. Lloyd had started a company to produce and sell holograms, as well as to produce laser light shows, which he did on the ground floor of our building. When I saw my first hologram, I fell in love. There was no other way to describe the sense of recognition and rightness that I felt, as so many others have too. Xu Min Lin, who worked with me for 5 years, had the same experience when he first saw his first hologram in Montreal in the Images du Futur show. I had a sense of destiny that something of great importance and great implications was in front of my eyes. We became good friends with Lloyd, and Peter and he applied together for a grant from the New York Council on the Arts, combining Peter's illusionistic sculptures with Lloyd's holograms. In the meantime, Linda had given birth to a baby, David. Their money was running out, and the question arose of where to go since their time in New York was coming to an end. We had friends from university who were teaching very liberal and exclusive private schools in Sedona, Arizona. Lloyd and we thought that after receiving the grant, going to Arizona was a great idea. We proposed starting a holography lab and giving lessons in holography. Verde Valley agreed to the idea, and we all set out west. In fact, the lab was built and holograms produced, and one day at lunch in the school cafeteria, Lloyd announced that he had invented a new way of making holograms, which he called multiplexing. This was April or May of 1972. On a 3-hour drive through Arizona desert, Peter and Lloyd debated what the future of holography was going to be. Peter convinced that it would be pulse holography and Lloyd that it would be multiplex. It was a discussion that lasted many days and showcased the different approaches to holography. Since that time, pulse holography has been the only holography that I have been involved in. Shortly after we all went to San Francisco and our separate ways, Lloyd founded his school of holography and produced the seminal piece, The Kiss. Linda and Lloyd divorced. Many years later, when David was a teenager visiting New York, I made a portrait of him. And the next year, while in California, I met Lloyd and showed him the portrait of his son, who he had not seen since he was a baby. He wept. In 1975, with the support of the Kaplan Fund, we started the non-profit organization Center for Experimental Holography at the Smithsonian Institute. The problem then arose of where to house the center and equipment. The only space the Smithsonian had available was in the incubator zoo. But after a quick visit, it became quite clear that sharing space with baby llamas and antelope was not the ideal environment. Miraculously, the possibility of having the center at Brookhaven National Laboratory in Long Island became a reality. Mr. Carl Rogers, head of the National Science Foundation, recommended us, and we ended up with our center and our lab in the midst of accelerators and high-energy physics. I say miraculously, and at the time, events did seem to be orchestrated by a very positive force. It was a time also of great openness to new ideas, experimentation, and so scientific institutions such as Brookhaven could open its doors to artists and a new medium. Brookhaven gave us a laboratory, space, and pretty much left us alone. When the equipment donated by McDonnell Douglas arrived, it was in bits and pieces, And from them, with the help of Will Walter and others, Peter reconstituted a pulse laser and camera designed for portraiture and art objects. It was a very exciting time. Though Alice and Jack Kaplan, with whom we had become friendly, we met Thomas Hoving, the director of the Metropolitan Museum. There was a lot of interest in the time about creating virtual museums and new technologies, and holography would hopefully have a place in them. In fact, Philip de Montebello, who later headed the Met, became a member of the board of the centre, and at the same time, holographic portraiture, with its possibilities and artistic medium, became my passion. We made a number of portraits of official people and friends. It was a time of experimenting and fun. Specifically, I remember one evening after a convenient dinner with nice wine, making with Peter a series of experimental portraits of Steve Benton bearing his chest. By 1978, Brookhaven had a new director and its laissez-faire attitude had changed. We needed to look for a new home. The University of Hawaii offered us space, and their physics department, despite discouraging sounds from friends and colleagues, we decided to accept their offer. With two growing children, the beaches of Hawaii and an easier lifestyle seemed to outweigh the disadvantages of isolation, the isolation of the island and its lack of technological sophistication. In Honolulu, the university reconstituted the pulse laser camera and transfer table. It was a very congenial and welcoming situation. We established connections with the Honolulu Art Academy. Local artists were invited to explore the medium. We made a portrait of the then governor, Ariyoshi, that was covered by local press and TV stations. In 1978, I produced an exhibition of portraits called Children of Hawaii that captured the beauty and diversity of the population. The exhibition was held at the Bishop Museum of Art. Unfortunately, in an eerie echo of things to come, the Kaplan Fund stopped our funding, and even though we tried to raise funds locally, it proved impossible. We closed the centre, returned the equipment to the Smithsonian, and pondered our next move. A local entrepreneur had seen our portraits and thought there'd be a huge market for white light open aperture portraits we were producing at the time. A company was formed which later became Holographics Inc. and we started a laboratory on the other side of the island. A long, tedious process of assembling another pulse laser started. After many false starts, Peter had it working fairly consistently. It was at this time that Peter began to concentrate more on the design of lasers than the medium of holography. We made portraits of Arnold Schwarzenegger, Anne Margaret, and many other local celebrities. Hoping to open up the markets in entertainment business, we developed point-of-sale purchases for Kieran Beer and others. However, the constant refrain was, come back to us when you have colour. Portraiture also proved hard to sell. The local Hawaiians thought that the people in the portraits were ghosts, and others thought they looked too real. The entrepreneur pulled out, and we once again were without funds. Things were so dire that the local kahuna, Mona Shimonia, who had befriended us and thought that holography showed a mystical side of things, tucked dollar bills into our hands to be able to buy film. Luckily, Mr. Mitsuo Kodera and Mr. Sakane of the Ashi Shimbun came to Hawaii and commissioned us to do a series of holograms for their exhibition in Japan, Alice Through the Looking Glass. This commission allowed us to pack up and go home. In New York, an old friend had bought a huge warehouse in Long Island City, now trendy, then industrial, and we relocated there. Holographics Inc. soon developed a two-tier company. The majority of the assets and energy were devoted to the development of pulse lasers for non-destructive testing. The other part created and developed display holography, which was under my care. To start with, we bought a 10-joule pulse laser from Lumonix with the help of Dr. John Webster, who was in England and later became part of the company. The laser was a monster that needed tuning every day. It gave us dim holograms, holograms with fringes, no holograms at all. I still remember testing for the good round burn that meant the laser was in tune. This was done by placing a black photographic paper at the exit of the beam and blasting it. The shape of the burn told us the state of the laser's alignment. It felt like every day I had to wrestle it to the ground to get good results. But when it was tuned properly, it produced beautiful, very bright, clean holograms, and I still have a soft spot for it. It was then that I developed the art of holographic portraiture. With children of Hawaii, you couldn't go wrong. The children were beautiful, playful, and totally natural in front of the holographic camera. It was a different case, however, with grown-ups. The dreaded wax look and unnatural expressions were common features of many portraits, although some beautiful ones were certainly produced by Edwina Orr and many others. In a photographic session, the photographer has a vast array of lighting options. He or she can change locations easily and can shoot many roles if necessary. With holography, however, the camera is fixed and the lighting of the subject on the whole is quite limited. When I had my pulse laser studio at the Museum of Holography, for example, I only had one object light directed in front of the sitter. It was only later that we used two object lights, and it was only when Dan and I designed the pulse laser camera at the Holo Center that we incorporated a much more flexible lighting configuration. When I started taking portraits, we were still using Agfa plates, and even though they were not as expensive as they later became, I could not take more than two or three recordings every session. This meant that the subject had to look and feel as relaxed and natural from the get-go. The art of portraiture, I found, especially holographic portraiture, begins by establishing a close and warm relationship with the client. It means fully engaging and responding the person and bringing out his or her psyche, a sense of authenticity. In many ways, it was a gift that the good portraitists needed to have. I can say that the years I studied practical, hands-on healing modalities such as polarity and Reiki were very helpful to me. The JK Laser in England had bought Luminonics and were eager to expand their markets. In 1987, the idea was proposed, I don't remember by whom, to have JK Lasers lend one of their one-joule pulse lasers to the Museum of Holography. Ian Lancaster had just started his directorship of the museum and was eager to have a pulse facility in it. John Webster engineered the loan and I became director of the Pulse Portrait Studio at the museum. After many delays, the laser was delivered to the museum the day that Webster was flying back to England. He quickly turned it on and ran to the airport. I was left to set it up by myself and to devise and construct a camera for the lower floor of the museum. It was a time of great stress for me. I had to design somehow have the studio built as well as the laser camera. My forte had been the art part of holography, and I felt overwhelmed. It did not help that Lancaster started to promote the Pulse Studio and line up publicity for it. Deadlines loomed. Luckily, John Klempner was with the museum and at the time very helpful and supportive. However, it was meeting Rudy Burkhout that was the turning point in my career as an artist and holographer. It was a very hot afternoon and I was working on the laser when I looked up and saw this very handsome and charming young man saying, "Can I help you?" It was Rudy, who I had not met before, although of course I knew who he was. Rudy and I became very close friends. He would bike over to the museum every afternoon and we'd go to the coffee shop on Canal Street and talk for hours. What does it mean to be an artist? What are the social and spiritual values that an artist has to confront? What is holographic art? Which is the best way to align the object beam? He gave me encouragement to think of myself as a holographic artist, to respect portraiture as an artistic medium, to experiment and explore the dimensions and space of the holographic medium. Later on, we collaborated in a series of self-portraits using slivers of our faces that was shown at the Holo Center last year. We also started on the road of studying and practicing healing modalities, but that is another story. For me, that summer and fall became the most transformative period of my life as an artist. It is extremely painful to think of my dear friend as gone. Soon the pulse laser camera was finished and we launched the studio with a bang. CNN sent Christina Ann Manpour with a crew and we made her portrait for a story that aired all over the world. We began to attract celebrities such as David Byrne of the Talking Heads, and the New Yorker did a cover story on that. Keith Haring came to New York, and the New York magazine covered it. It was a very heady time, and we were convinced that holographic portraits would become popular and ubiquitous. The portraits were shot at the museum, but transferred at our Long Island facility at Holographics. At that time, I made a series of portraits of Olympic gold medalists and had a show of them, the Olympics. We continued to do portraits of well-known people such as Philip Johnson, the architect, Walter Cronkite, Gloria Steinem, the Bishop of New York, Paul Moore, George Plimpton, Arthur Schlesinger, and a number of others. In 1989, I had an exhibition of portraiture at the museum called Persons, Personas, and Personalities. In 1992, the museum closed. We all felt it was a grievous blow to holography. Holographics, Inc. bought the Pulse Laser from JK Lasers, and we set it up in our facility in Long Island City. Xu Minlin, who had come to work for me, helped me with a large series of holograms and nudes I had started in the museum called Into the Night. My model and muse was a Korean dancer and choreographer, April Yao, and she was magnificent. I would tell her what I wanted to express with her body and her body responded impeccably. With Into the Night nudes, I was exploring the impetus of the spirit for flight and the longing of the integration of the human psyche. Most of the holograms were 50 by 60 centimetres. To give a sense of movement, of flight, I would often make two exposures as the figure moved with her hair streaming upwards. I also combined several masses into a single transfer. Many of these transfers were also colour mixed to avoid the monotony of the monochromatic or single colour exposure. I also worked with plastic surgeon Dr. Gregory LaTrenta, who performed pro bono operations on children with hair lips. We did recordings before and after, they were very moving. The consensus on why reflection holography had not taken off as we all expected was lack of colour. Colour mixes were beautiful. John Kaufman was a master at it, but it was not the answer. Rudy and I became quite intrigued with Edmund Land's theories of colour, especially the notion that red and green were sufficient to create acceptable palette, since, according to him, the brain could be tricked into seeing blue where none was. I bought an argon laser, and Rudy designed an elegant setup with the green argon and the red Heaney beams, culminating simultaneously on panchromatic emulsions. We worked on colour holography for several months and did get some interesting results, but not good enough, and we eventually abandoned the experiment. In 1997, I met Larry DiCarlo, director of the Fishbank Gallery, then on 57th Street. He was very taken with my work, both the nudes and the portraits. He offered me a show and I jumped at it. It seemed that art holography would finally break the New York art scene. By then, Xu Min had left and I needed someone to help me prepare the show. I'd heard that Dan Schweitzer was back from California painting houses for a living. I had a great deal of trepidation asking him to come and work with me. To me, it was like asking Picasso to help you mix your paints. He came, a prince of a man, and we worked together seamlessly. My exhibition, Portraits in Laser Light, opened in January 1997, and in February, Larry displayed some of my holograms in the Armory show to great interest. Posey Jackson, who had been so instrumental in the development of holography and so supportive of it, had never made a hologram. And so in the spring of 1996, when she came to Holographics Lab with Margaret Bennion to produce some pieces in collaboration, Dan and I helped facilitate their ideas and we all had a great time. I mention this because it was the germ of an idea for a holographic centre was born. Posey was impressed by how well Dan and I worked together and how she felt that perhaps something more could have been done for the popularisation of holography. At that time, she was studying for the priesthood and had a very full plate, but she still had time to meet with John Webster and start a dialogue with him about different options. John, an expert in lasers in England, had been an ardent supporter of holography and advisor to Holographics, Inc. The company had been developing systems for non-destructive testing, specifically for aeroplanes. John relocated to New York, and we had begun work, and we'd been where we had been working at Holographics for several years. Again, the confluence of events came together seamlessly. Holographics was bought by a German company who had no interest in display holography and wanted to close down the pulse laser facility. The company owed me quite a lot of back pay, and so I agreed to receive the equipment in lieu of debt. So I own the pulse laser, a camera, a good continuous wave Heaney, my Argon, but Dan and I were jobless. It was then that the Shearwater Foundation gave us a grant to start a holography centre. What a wonderful time it was. Dan and I talked for hours creating the architecture and aims of this fledgling entity. The first and best decision we made was to be co-directors. I was a bit worried about what would happen if we had disagreements. We were sitting in this local coffee shop and I was venting about my negative experiences with male bosses and technics. He got up and said he would be back in 5 minutes. Later, he reappeared with a silver dollar he'd gone and got from the bank. If we disagree, he said, this will be the tiebreaker. We never once used that coin. So the Centre of Holographic Arts came to be. We found a wonderful location on the ground floor with a 3-foot cement underneath the floor. It was in Long Island City, 2 blocks from MoMA's PS1, the Sculpture Centre, and 5 minutes from Midtown Manhattan. We had a banner fabricated and hung it outside, and we were incorporated as a non-profit in 1998. All summer, we designed and built a very flexible pulse laser camera, an exhibition space, a transfer lab with concrete slabs and inner tubes, and worked a workshop in a darkroom. We also produced a mission statement. The main goal of the Holo Center, as it became known, was to promote the art of holography. At the core was an artist-in-residence program. We reached out not just to holographers, but also to artists working in other mediums who would incorporate holography as part of their artistic vocabulary. The artists were chosen by a jury of art professionals and would have 2 weeks to work at the centre under our supervision. Later, as our funding diminished, we changed the period of grant to 1 week. To this moment, more than 60 artists from all over the world have come to work at this Holo Centre, and much of their work has been exhibited internationally. Secondly, the centre had exhibitions of holographic art open to the public. We were the only place in New York where you could see art holography. The centre also had a hands-on internship program that attracted students from as far as Japan and Australia. It also offered classes in beginner and advanced holography to encourage a new batch of young artists to pursue this wonderful medium. We were also a production facility and had our funding increased by doing commercial jobs such as portraits, point-of-purchase displays, and even some holograms for NASA. It was a great time. The centre was the only place where artists could come and work with both pulse and transfer table, assisted by well-respected holographic artists for free. It was the only place in New York where the community of holographers would meet and through our website keep abreast of current developments in the medium. Holography, as we all know, is a very hard discipline, frequently frustrating, but Dan and I had a lot of fun and were full of plans for the future of the centre. Then, in late 2000, Dan developed a persistent cough that turned out to be a malignancy. For many months, Dan still came in and helped artists who were doing work here, but for me, a shadow descended on the centre, and on December 5th, 2001, we lost our beloved colleague. I felt bereaved and devastated, but after a long thought, I decided to continue the mission that Dan and I worked so hard to achieve, and I was very fortunate to have Ikuo Nakamura join us and later Sam Morey. Financially, the centre was in dire straits. Despite our vigorous fundraising efforts, holography was hard to sell. To survive, we formed a partnership with a commercial company, Ravel, run by Joe Civelli, and developed commercial products. The artist-in-residence program continued in tandem with our work for Ravel, as well as our exhibition schedule. In 2004, I had an exhibition with Ikuo Nakamura at the Green Street Gallery in Soho, The Body Electric, where we showed and installed installations of videos and holograms. A laser viewable piece with laser beam configurations, a metre high and double exposure aperture piece called Union. Later in 2005, the exhibition was shown at the Butler Institute of American Art in Ohio. Our financial situation continued to be very precarious. Ravel pulled out its financial support and we could not get any funding from the main foundations we applied to. I was ready to close the doors when the Holography Fund was established and the Holo Centre received a generous grant that allowed us to continue. Although our budget was very tight, none of the principals received any salary and the number of artists in residence was cut. Thanks to a small grant from the Queen's Council on the Arts, we also continued our exhibitions. This has pretty much been the story up to now. In 2007, I had a show at the centre, Hide and Seek. It was the best show I ever had done, and it felt like a swan song. I used photography, video and holography to delve into the psychic anxieties about ageing and mortality, explored in three different media using myself as the subject matter. Rudy Burkhout and I had collaborated in some portraits in the early 90s using slivers of each other's faces and combining them in transfer pieces. They had never been shown until 2008, and when we had the exhibition at the centre, Holographic Collaborations. It was the last exhibition Rudy had alive, and I think he was very pleased with it. My most recent exhibition, Portraits in Laser Light, was last year at the Butler. And now we come to the end. Last year we received notification that the Holography Fund was supporting us for the year 2009 and our 11th year of life. We started preparing, soliciting proposals for the Artists in Residence program and planning a retrospective exhibition of Rudy's work. Then in February, we were notified that the Holography Fund closed and all funding was cancelled. The blow was sudden, unexpected, and at this time, I did not have any other options for funding and sadly decided to close the doors behind at the end of June, after Rudy's exhibition. We were very happy that the last show at the centre was Rudy's work, and it was so spectacular. It reminded us all of how magical the medium can be. We are closing our New York's facility, but the centre will continue. We have come to an agreement with Ohio State University to house the centre and to reconstitute the pulse laser camera. Ohio State has a very attractive holography program under the direction of Dr. Harris Kagan, in conjunction with the art department. Artists will be welcome to come and use the facility. Down the line, Harris hopes to raise enough funds to re-establish the Artists in Residence program. The exhibition program under the direction of Martina Rongovius will be housed in New York at the Flux Factory, a respected non-profit arts institution. So we'll have the Center for the Holographic Arts in Ohio State and the Flux Factory. It is a new beginning. Thank you.